Well, we're continuing in our series that we started at the beginning of the year, Will We Grow? And basically it's about growing in our faith and how we can do that in different ways. And today we're going to talk about growing in our service. And we're going to start the sermon out a little bit different. So Sarah's going to come up and she's going to serve you.
If you lead me.
Maybe we ought to start out the sermon that way every week. Huh? The reason we did that this morning, I wanted to show you or give you an example of how we can serve God and how we can serve other people. And we do that the best when we utilize our gifts, gifts that God has given us. And God has given Sarah a very special gift, her voice. We actually found that out when she was in sixth grade. Her choir director in school, who was also the choir director in the Baptist church, recognized her talent and helped her, gave her some lessons and helped her along with that. And Sarah's always wanted to use it in church. In fact, she did for a few years in a big church in Green. But then she had some complications with mental illness, and that's hampered her from doing that for like the last 20 years. But then God gave her a miracle and healed her. And she's off all her meds now. And praise God, we've got Sarah back. And she, when we decided to do the contemporary service at 9:30, I asked Sarah if she wanted to be a part of that. And she said, by all means. Now she's leading it and doing a wonderful job. So anyway, this is just one of the ways that we can serve God and serve other people with our gift. And that's what, like I said, that's what we're going to talk about today, is our service. So today our scripture comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 20, verses 20 through 28. If you want to follow along in the Pew Bible, it's on page 980. And I would invite you to listen to the Word of God in a special way whenever you hear it proclaimed aloud, or whenever you hear someone speak, or even when you're reading the Bible. Ask God to speak to you through His Word, because it has the power to change our lives. Amen? So hear the Word today. Then the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus with her sons. She knelt respectfully to ask a favor. "What is your request?" he asked. And she replied, "In your kingdom, please let my two sons sit in the places of honor next to you, one on your right and the other on your left." But Jesus answered by saying to them, "You don't know what you're asking. Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering that I'm about to drink?" "Oh yes," they replied, "we are able." So Jesus told them, "You will indeed drink from my bitter cup, but I have no right to say who will sit on my right or my left. My Father has prepared those places for the ones he has chosen." When the 10 other disciples heard what James and John had asked, they were indignant. But Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers in this world lord it over their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first among you must become your slave. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many." This is the Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks
be to God. So every time I read this story, I think to myself, what were James and John thinking? Why did they get their mother to go to Jesus and make this unbelievable request? I mean, this wasn't just a small request. This was huge. It was very bold. to go to Jesus with this request. Please let my sons sit in the seats of honor next to you when you come into your kingdom. Ooh, that's pretty rash. Do you think maybe they thought that they could serve the people better if they said Jesus right and Jesus left? Do you think that's what they were thinking? I don't. Actually, I think they were thinking about themselves. They were thinking about that high position of authority and about how people would see them as they sat next to Jesus. They were thinking about their own selfish ambition. Well, none of the disciples were perfect. We know that in the stories that we read. I mean, they were imperfect people just like you and I. But they were people that Jesus had called to come and serve. But they still made mistakes. In fact, all of them argued amongst one another, okay, who's the greatest in the kingdom among us? Who's the greatest? Can you imagine? Yet Jesus still loved them. He still taught them. In fact, he told them, you need to understand something. You want to be the greatest in the kingdom of God, then you need to be the least in the kingdom of God. And whoever wants to be first, you must be last. Well, evidently, they didn't listen. Either that or they just didn't get it. They were used to what this world sees as the greatest and the best. I mean, all our lives, we're taught to be successful. We're taught that we need to strive to be number one. We're taught that we should do everything we can to gain places of high honor. Now, don't get me wrong here. I'm not saying that that's not a good thing. Striving to do the best that we can, striving to be number one, that's a good thing. The problem is this what we focus on. If that's the only thing that we focus on and we forget who we are, we lose sight who we really are, we lose sight of what's really important in life, then we begin to look like what James and John did in their mother that day when they made that request to Jesus. You see, material possessions, seats of honor, those type of things, they don't last forever. They last for a short while. But loving God and loving others and serving others and making a real difference in their lives, that's what lasts. You see, there's something greater than great. In fact, there's something more successful than success itself. And that's significance. You hear the word? Significance. You see, we become significant to others through our service. Through what we do for God and what we do for others. And significance happens when we seek to make a real difference in the lives of others. It's the art of combining compassion, concern, caring, and love for those people around us. All people around us. The question is, what can I give my family, my community, and world to hold on to that will never fade away? Well, I guarantee you, I'll never forget Sarah's sermon through her voice, through sharing her gift. That will always be right here in my heart, and I'm sure yours too. You see, true success follows significance. You know, many have given their lives that have gone before us and become very significant. What they did is they used their gifts that God gave them to make a difference. What I'm talking about is Mother Teresa. You know, she lowered herself completely to the bottom to serve everyone, and especially those who were lost and in need. Martin Luther King gave his life. Paul, Peter, James, John, the disciples, gave their lives so that you and I could know who Jesus Christ is. Now, Jesus warns us to be careful when we strive to be first or great. And he says some crazy things whenever he warns us. Things like, those who humble themselves will be exalted, and he who exalts himself will be brought down. He takes the things of this world and he flips them. In the kingdom of God, those who are first will be last, and those who are last shall be first. What? To save your life, you must lose it. What? To save your life, you must lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake, you will find it. In other words, if you give me your heart and your life and let me guide you and lead you, you will find a life that you never could have imagined and have a life that's blessed more than you could ever expect, no matter what's going on. In other words, what Jesus is saying is we are to love and serve God and others before ourselves. When we do that, we become significant. We become successful. Did you hear what Jesus said himself? He said, I came not to be served, but to serve and give my life as a ransom for all. I came not to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for all. The word ransom actually means something given in exchange for something else. Well, that's exactly what the Lord did. He gave his life in exchange for our lives. He gave his life and paid the price for our sins and gave that in exchange for eternal life for all of us. That's serving in the highest way possible. Now, again, don't get me wrong. We serve God and we serve people in this church in many, many ways. The question is, can we do more? Can we grow in our service? I say yes. And one of the biggest ways we can serve other people is to let them know God loves them. And we do too. I always talk about my friend in Lakey, Texas. He's a pastor of the Methodist Church there for a long time. In his simple way of serving people, he did not leave one person without telling them, smile, God loves you. I cannot imagine how many conversations that one sentence led to where people came to know Jesus Christ, forgave their sins, and loved him beyond anything they could ever expect. When he passed away, that little bitty church, there were over 100 people attending that little bitty church in Lakey, Texas. I think the population is something like 500, something like that. Over 100 people worshiping learning more about God, serving more people, spreading the love of Jesus Christ all over the community. It's also important to know something else. And I don't think we do it enough. It's important that you invite people to church. First of all, let them know God loves them. Build a relationship. But then invite them to come and to join in learning and loving each other in fellowship and worship. 92% of the people that begin going to church go because somebody invited them to church. 92%. That's huge. The thing is, I don't think we think about that in our daily lives. And that's something we can change. That's something that we can grow in. If we think about it and ask God to tap us on the shoulder and remind us to do it when the time comes. You never know who needs an ear. You know, I would invite you to share that saying that Doug shared with her. Smile. God loves you. And when that person says, well, I don't know about that, share your story and how you found out that Jesus loves you. And they just might end up here. You never know. But at least the word has been shared with them, the gospel of Jesus Christ, those seeds have been planted. And I think we can grow in planting those seeds. Amen?
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for those who invited us to church. We thank you for those who have gone before us and who have served you well. And who have served us because they wanted us to know that you love us too. So Lord, help us each day to think more about that and to share more of that love with those around us. And Lord, when those options come, when those opportunities come, we ask that you speak through us, that you bless those that we talk to and that we try to help, so that they too can grow in the knowledge of your love and grace. All this we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.